Welcome to St. Leo's Catholic community and a special welcome to all our guests. Today we are reminded that nothing will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Our celebrant is Father Torpey. These are your announcements. Anyone interested in the Catholic Church, whether they are baptized or not, may wish to join the RCIA process this fall. If that is you, or you know of someone who is interested, please call Father Don Berman at the office. This month, the newsletter is distributed by social media, on our webpage and email. A few hard copies are available in the media or for visitors. A few hard copies are available in the parish gathering area each month for those who do not have a social media or for visitors. If you do not receive it for some reason, please let us know and we will follow up as soon as possible. Next weekend, we will extend a blessing upon all the college-bound students and young people leaving for home this fall. Come and celebrate and support them. There will not be a Mass at 9 a.m. on Thursday due to the Memorial Mass for Don Kosovich. Please pray for his wife Dolores and the family. First Friday Adoration is this coming Friday from 9:30 to 1 p.m. Benediction. The sign-up sheet is on the south counter. We need two people present for each half hour. Come before the Lord and pray. We now invite you to take a moment of silence to acknowledge your needs, remember your blessings, and pray for those who may die this week. We ask you to silently pray in Our Father, Hail Mary, and Glory Be.
Let's join together in singing Table of Plenty.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
And we gather here the great gospel of Jesus feeding the multitude with just a few fish and loaves. And so we open our hearts the way that the Lord wants to nourish us, but perhaps we have chosen some other type of nourishment. Lord Jesus, you feed us with your body and blood. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you fill us with your spirit for life. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you call us to the table of abundance forever. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come receive grain and eat. Come without pain and without cost, drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedily, listen, that you may have life. I will renew you with the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, what will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress, or persecution or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or the sword? No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor present things nor future things, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Dismissed the crowds so that they could go to the villages and buy food for themselves. Jesus said to them, "There is no need for them to go away. Give them some food yourselves." But they said to him, "Five loaves and two fish are all that we have here." Then he said, "Bring them here to me." And he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and the two fish and looking up to heaven, he said the blessing, broke the loaves, and gave them to the disciples, who in turn gave them to the crowds. They all ate and were satisfied, and they picked up the fragments left over, 12 wicker baskets full. Those who ate were about 5,000 men, not counting women and children. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, welcome to weird times, huh? So years ago, I heard this German word, Weltschmerz. I just love it. And it means world pain. And I think it really applies today. We are living in a world that is full of pain, whether it's the COVID thing or the Black Lives Matter or the Blue Lives Matter. And there's just all sorts of ugliness out there, and it's very hard to get away from it. And besides that, we're all having to stay at home or try to stay at home or stay away from other people. And a couple months ago, my sister called and said, "How am I doing?" She said, "Fine." I said, "Fine." She said, "How's your mental health?" I said, "I have no idea. I haven't been around anybody. How would I know?" So then about a month after that, some lady from the doctor's office called me about some medication. And she said, "How are you doing?" I said, "Fine." "And how are you doing with the isolation?" I said, "I'm doing okay so far." She said, "You don't go out?" I said, "No, I don't go out." I said, "But I'm an introvert. I kind of like it. I only need one human contact a week, and you're it." But there's an awful lot of craziness that goes on. Partly you don't know all the week. We just don't know everything about this virus. But also, it takes an effect on us. How are we going to be normal human? And on, just on the human level, it's kind of interesting that the gospel would come at this time in this pandemic. Because when you stop to think about it, you know, you can get your food delivered or go pick it up or whatever, but what is it you really need? Somehow, one of the most basic things we need is some type of human contact. And I'll never forget the first time I went out to eat about 6 weeks after I was in. I thought, my goodness, this is wonderful being around another human being, and I kind of like them too. So it's like, you know, and we all kind of need that. And so when Jesus says he's going to feed everybody, the gospel people and their Christian community would know, no, it's not just bread. It's the other stuff of the Spirit that feeds us that we really need. So it's kind of a helpful thing to think about. And I love that that opening song, Come to the Feast, because can you fill all our needs? Yes, that's true. And perhaps maybe we've come to know some of those needs a little bit better. Part of it is how are we going to be with this, and where do we see the Lord in this? So it seems to me one way to think about Jesus present to all of this suffering and all this death and all this separation and all this discomfort and all this pain that people are going through is, in spite of what we can't do, the Lord Jesus is out there just holding everybody, giving everybody a hug. Now, you know, in some cities, they have people out there thanking the first responders and all that. I mean, there's all sorts of ways that you read about people doing some wonderful act of kindness or gratitude or whatever. And it just kind of just warms the cockles of my heart because, wow, here's somebody doing something that you never think you'd do in a normal life, but, you know, it's the only thing you can do. So part of it is we're trying to figure out how to be good and how to be normal, and sometimes you can't quite get there. Now, this gospel appears in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but it's different in John because in John, it is the chapter 6. It is the story. It is his main description of the Eucharist. So in the Gospel of John, you don't have anything about the Lord's Supper. The only thing you have in the Gospel of John is the washing of feet. So for John, this appears in chapter 6, and he's talking about the Eucharist, and he uses these exact same words of Jesus in this Gospel that we use in the Eucharist. He took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples. So this is kind of a different take on it, because in the middle of this, Jesus said, well, give them something to eat. And the other gospel, Philip says, who's going to take $200 to go to get food for all these people? So it's really a miracle of Jesus feeding all sorts of people, not only, as we come to know, with the bread of life and the fish, but also with the incredible power of God's love and the meaning of Jesus being with us and for us. Now, years ago, I heard somebody say, well, somebody said the miracle is that everybody shared what they had and had enough. I'm not sure I believe that. I didn't care for that. But I just read it not too long ago, the real commentary on that, 60, 70 years ago. And the guy said, one way to think about the miracle, or some people, is that the disciples had these 5 loaves and 2 fish, and they just started sharing with people around them, and other people shared what they had. I don't think that's necessarily the whole point of the thing, but it's interesting way some people think about that. I never would have thought of it. But it is certainly true that unless the gifts we have are shared, unless other people share their gifts, we are going to be mighty hungry and mighty empty and very close to death. Because unless we have a way of saying, you know, God wants more for all of us, we're not getting that message. So I was at Father Larmore's funeral the other day. They had distancing and masks and everything. There were not too many people there. And for communion, Father Marty says, so for communion, the priest's going to come up, you just take the host, receive as you do the host, and then do intinction, just put the host in the sacred blood, and then go around and avoid people and everything else. I thought to myself, that is one of the most awful liturgical things every priest doesn't like. It's just an awful way to do liturgy. But what are you going to do, have 20 chalices up there? So there's all sorts of things that this COVID has done to our liturgy, not to mention being all that separated and all that stuff, but also not being able to recognize and be recognized in the community that you're a part of. Where do you belong? Well, I belong someplace besides my TV, and I belong with other people. The other thing is, there are people who are, a lot of priests I talk to are concerned about, are people ever going to come back to church? Well, you know, if you've been away from church for 3 or 4 months, of course, we all have a dispensation. You don't have to be here. Maybe they won't come back, because maybe if they were gone for 3 or 4 months and didn't miss it, why would they come back? So we live in a weird time, not just now, but we live in a time where people, for a while, years maybe, have not gotten much out of the Eucharist, because we don't talk about the meaning of it. We don't get to what's going on in the world. So it's not that all of a sudden this COVID is making our liturgy bad. A lot of times they're bad to begin with, and partly because we have a lot of flat-minded priests and people who just want to get Jesus and go. They just want to get the thing and they're gone. Have no sense of the community and the way we get nurtured by other people and by sharing in the Eucharist with listening to the readings, reflecting on the readings, doing the singing, getting in procession, and being with on a deeper level. So the most basic symbol of the Eucharist, of course, is the meal. But in a lot of places, it's got to reduce to the bread and wine, and now it's just the bread. So it's not a happy time, and the prospects aren't too good. So what are you going to do? Well, for me, it's time to get back to that basic thing of how is it that Jesus nourishes us after we receive the body of Christ? Well, we get filled with the Spirit. And we get filled with the Spirit for every possible need, especially these days, for people to know that they belong, that they matter, that they are worthwhile, that people care about them, and that there is help out there, and that perhaps one of these days we'll be able to be more fully human again. And it seems to me that we have to go back again to that image of Jesus is out there holding us and embracing us and holding us together as much as we need, more than we can imagine. So it's kind of a great gospel to think about. Jesus, it's one of the nice things about this, Jesus makes it pretty clear that he needs other people to do his work. Now we need Jesus, but Jesus needs us. Jesus needs all of us to go out there and do something that we ordinarily wouldn't think about doing, or that we thought about doing, or all of a sudden it's easy to do. And sometimes it's pretty hard. Sometimes there's no way I can figure out what I can do to help you. But we don't see them like you do on TV. But I think of all these, even in Grand Island here on Saturdays, they have somebody, 1,000 baskets for people who need food. I mean, there's stuff out there that's really good. Now, the other thing about this gospel is, it's connected with that first reading. So in that first reading, this is Isaiah 55, so it's late. It's later in Isaiah. It's probably after the Israelites are coming back from exile. And he is saying to them, come to the feast. I just love this song. I've been singing that for 3 weeks, and all of a sudden, here we are. Thank you, Jesus. Come to the feast of heaven and earth. Anyway, it's Isaiah saying, come to this. You don't have to pay for bread. It's all free. Come to this feast that God wants for us. So the Eucharist is that feast. And the Eucharist is that feast that has a straight line to the feast in heaven of the final fullness of everything God wants for us. So part of it is Isaiah is saying it's all free, it's all a gift. And we have to come here and say that. We come here because we know we are so blessed. No matter how hard it is, we know we are blessed. We know our God is with us. Our God is holding us, and our God is holding everybody else, and he's trying to help us do that same thing. So we come to the feast, and we say, yes, I need the Eucharist, but I need everything that comes with it. I need every bit of that Spirit of Jesus that we receive at every Eucharist. And we need the feast, we need that abundance, and also we need to be able to say, you know, I need some hope, I need some joy, I need something for this emptiness, I need something for all this hurt, I need something for all this sadness, I need something for all this stuff that goes on that is so not what God wants. God wants all those gifts, and they're free, and they're being poured out to us. Let us stand up, Professor. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess all my sins for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And we pray to our God who calls us to the feast and promises us abundance for all our needs.
That church leaders, stewards of our faith, will live in a way that will draw all believers to know Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the world's government authorities will work together in the cause of global peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who live with chronic illness will find assurance that they are always in God's tender care. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who share pastoral gifts of hospitality be blessed with patience and loving hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the dead know the mercy of God and the promise of the eternal kingdom, especially Lucille Riceland of our parish. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That school administrators, parents, and students all make wise decisions about this school year and how to educate our children. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our parish will grow in faith and respect for all believers. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for our church that it be a church that all want to come to, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Holy God, you bless us with fullness of life in Jesus, your Son. Free our hearts for every need that we know of. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all the Holy Church.
O God, graciously sanctify these gifts, and accepting the offering of the spiritual sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation. Always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity, and even fashioned for us a remedy out of mortality itself, so that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Christ our Lord. Through him the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exult and praise as we acclaim.
Oh,
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Joseph our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And let us pray for the fullness of God's kingdom of forgiveness and healing in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen."
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
Thank you.
We need another patent from the sacristy for the third cup for communion. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Let us pray. O God, accompany with constant protection those you renew with these heavenly gifts, and in your never-failing care for us, make us worthy of eternal salvation. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, love, and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'd like to thank Father Torpey for taking time out of his busy schedule to come help us tonight. So thanks, Father. Let's sing Rain Down.